您好，同志们，我的名字是何伟丽。到了1983年，我开始学习汉语在南开大学。南开大学是在中国人民共和国。谁人听懂吗？ Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Bill Hagestad. Many of you have heard me speak before at last year's DEF CON, Biohacking Village. I introduced the Chinese military weapon, bioweapon systems program. I think it's funny that here we are sitting in a pandemic. Today, we're going to be talking about the very same group, the People's Liberation Army, and their bioweapons laboratory mission regarding Operation COVID-19. It's very important to understand this bottom line up front. All of this research that I'm going to present today comes from within the People's Republic of China. There is nothing that is regurgitated U.S. government hyperbole. There is no hyperbole from the Western press. All this Chinese view is factually based upon what the Chinese are viewing of their own dilemma in the face of the Wuhan pneumonia. The Chinese military, of course, is testing new antiviral protocols on their own soldiers, not intending to use that on civilian subjects. China is also very concerned more about the U.S. and its apparent lack of control in containing this pandemic. They see a lot of the disparaging comments made by the leadership of the United States as some sort of significant lack of leadership on the global stage. They also, from the Communist Party view, see this military loss of control of this bioweapons globally as a U.S. issue, not necessarily Chinese. But in the shadow of this doubt, China cannot help but think of the military-to-military cooperation. Certainly knowing that the history goes back to the very founding of the Communist Party of China when the U.S. supported General Chiang Kai-shek when Mao Zedong used Japanese insurgents to run him off to Taiwan. And then last but not least, in the bluff portion, while the source of the pandemic is critically important in terms of containment, really now more than ever, cooperation is something that the Chinese military is looking for. Now, as we enter this combination of the binary world and the bioweapons world, I offer you a chance to look deep inside the Chinese view of this. And really, this is a respectful, factual research regarding how the Chinese military bioweapons labs are contained, used, and otherwise operationalized within the People's Republic of China, and those potential implications for weaponizing viruses, perhaps from a Western view, such as what we are calling COVID-19. This is ultimately Xi Jinping's test on the nation stage. So there is no one left unharmed here, and there is no disrespect intended towards any country, culture, or other part of society. Now, this pandemic that we're facing is truly an international issue. There is no doubt about that. The challenge, however, as you'll see at the end of this presentation, is who is cooperating with who to actually deal with this pandemic as a global issue rather than a singular national crisis. Now, in the Chinese view, they call it Wuhan pneumonia. And they're asking themselves, is it a biological weapon? Is it not a biological weapon? This critical question is one that is still talked about in the Chinese press on a regular basis. Now, you might be asking yourself, why do we not hear about this in the Western press? Well, it's quite simple. If you had heard about it, then it would be something that would be used against the Chinese. It's interesting, not only from a military perspective, but a civilian economic perspective. A lot of the news that they put out, while it may be contained and constrained according to the communist message machine, it is still out there for consideration by the average Chinese citizen. This lets you know that the Chinese are attempting to work through this rather than castigate it themselves or another country. They will admit fault in this. And one of the most important pieces is the way that they regard the Biosafety Lab 4 in Wuhan in Hubei, China. It's interesting because the Wuhan Institute of Virology, as you can see in the upper left-hand corner of your slide, is not too far from what is known in the West as the wet market. While there are many mysteries and gossip placed about what happened, monkeys, et cetera, it's interesting that these are only perhaps 12 kilometers away, 20 minutes or so by car. What's interesting, though, is that they, being the Chinese Communist Party, recognize that that biosafety lab in Wuhan is actually that the coronavirus is where it originated. Now, it's really curious because the outside world, that would be you and I and the rest that are not Chinese, we believe that that lab, that BSL-4, is related to the Communist Party's secret biological weapons program. You would be correct. What is interesting is in the press, and you can see the URL down below, this comes directly out of China, is that a lot of the virologists are indicating that this is indeed a man-made virus. This is, if you will, the smoking gun. This is something that is very interesting that has not been admitted by the Chinese Communist Party. But it's critical from a societal perspective, say these experts inside China, that the Communist Party admit that it was a mistake and move on. And I'll give you some further facts that will demonstrate that this is indeed something that needs to be controlled. Now, the Chinese view this as an accidental virus that escaped the lab. It was an experiment that failed. In other words, they believe that indeed the Wuhan pneumonia or COVID-19 was indeed a man-made virus that accidentally left the lab. This is quite contrary to what we are hearing in the press, because you can imagine at the nation state level, the Chinese are denying that it happened. Yet here in the Chinese press, there are evidences that indeed it was man-made. Now, if we get back to that South China seafood market in the city of Wuhan in Hubei province, you'll notice that there is quite a bit of activity regarding this BSL-4 lab, biosafety 4 lab. Now, you may be asking yourself, what is a biosafety lab if you're not a biohacker? Well, a biosafety lab category 4, we have one here at the University of Minnesota, is the most stringently controlled, securitized testing facility for all manner of man-made viruses that could kill you in an instant. It is critical. It's observed and monitored by many agencies in the U.S. government, and the FBI field office here in Minneapolis maintains a tight control on who has access to that with the University of Minnesota. So you can imagine that that same level of security scrutiny takes place in Wuhan, in Hebei, China. This is important to note because you may be asking yourself, well, what does a BSL-4 look like? Well, indeed, here it is. If you're familiar with the Hobbit Trail, you'll notice that there are bridges that are air-controlled dynamically, allowing access and entrance into this biosafety lab. It is specifically contained away from the civilian areas. You'll note the containment pond behind it, along with the physical separation, not only with the high security fences, but the fact that the facility is very much tightly under not only local police, provincial police, but more importantly, the military's protection. Now, you may be asking yourself, how does the military factor into this? Well, this is very important because, as you'll note, and I'll introduce you to one of the generals of the Chinese military that took over this lab back in February, the BSLP-4 in Wuhan actually was taken over by the military. And what is interesting is if there was no military connection, why indeed did the military take over this BSL-4 lab? And that is one of the questions that they are asking inside China. Essentially, if it were effectively a controlled experimental location at that BSL-4 lab, P4, in Wuhan, there would have been no need for the Chinese military to go in and take a step. So let's introduce you to the nuclear biological chemical weapons cadre of the People's Liberation Army. A note for the audience, I am indeed a visiting scholar at the PLA's number one think tank, the NOFAR Institute. So many of these are coming directly from my partners and associates, fellow scholars inside the People's Republic of China. You'll note by the URL 81.cn down below that that is a military website. And if you go there, certainly using a VPN and perhaps a collapsible OS, you'll be able to review some of these same photos. Now, what's interesting is that the Chinese military, in their entrance and deployment into Wuhan, actually came across the Wuhan facility that was actually testing monkeys. You can see the cages off to the right there. This is also very near the Wuhan wet or seafood market and the BSLP-4 laboratory. The Chinese military discovered this as they were deploying, and they're wondering, certainly it's possible that something of this nature could have come out of a wet market, but perhaps there is more compelling evidence that maybe it escaped from this animal laboratory testing facility. Now, the P4 biochemical laboratory, as I mentioned, being separate, is also near this very other Model Animal Research Institute of Wuhan University. What's interesting is this Wuhan University noted that the very earliest pneumonia cases were in November, and record of a human interaction or infection of this was on December 1 of 2019. Now, if you are following history, many of us were thinking, well, this will never come to the United States. Unfortunately, the Chinese have been very reluctant to figure out where the source of this epidemic was, given the lead time in terms of where their infectious experts were able to focus within the People's Republic of China. But much of the research focuses specifically in Wuhan, as I mentioned, in Hubei province in northeast China. Now, as we get to the military, let's introduce you to a very important personage in this Chinese military website. She is known as the Chinese military Ebola Terminator. She has quite the notable achievements in terms of controlling different types of diseases that have not only emanated but spread throughout China, including most notably the containment of Ebola, SARS, H1N1, and other viruses. Her name specifically is Major General Chen Wei. Now, she works as part of the Chinese Engineering Academy. And of course, according to the Chinese website, they have been noted that she has been playing, quote unquote, with drugs for over 30 years. I mentioned her Ebola and SARS Terminator nom de guerre, but she's been the leading doctor from a military perspective in terms of fighting infectious diseases within the People's Republic of China. Now, on the 26th of January, 2020, General Chen Wei brought in a team of military experts to Wuhan, China. They realized that they were starting to have an outbreak. And 2 days later, they discovered that there indeed was a detection kit that noted that there was coronavirus 2019 and COVID basically resident within the Wuhan VSLP4. Now, what's interesting is this detection kit had been jointly developed to detect this type of military record of nuclear, biological, and chemical effects with the Military Medical Research Institute of China. It's one of their state-owned enterprises, which is interesting. This will play important towards the end of the presentation. Now, what's really very interesting about the approval of this is that it received emergency Communist Party approval by the National Medical Products Administration. Typically, this does not happen very effectively unless there is a national emergency. In this case, they received a registration certificate to use this within a military environment within 2 days. Now, of course, with the deployment of the military, much like in any civilian nation state, certainly the U.S. being no exception, the Chinese take it very seriously. And when Chen Wei deployed with her troops to Wuhan, she noticed that the potentiality for an enemy, an adversary, picking up bioweapons that were developing in Wuhan, during a wartime, was quite a serious event. And certainly in peacetime, she noted that a large-scale epidemics such as Wuhan pneumonia, now known as COVID-19, could indeed bring disaster to an entire country and nation. So basically, she started to create what's called a biological military shield, essentially protecting the rest of China while putting her troops and herself in jeopardy within the city of Wuhan as they went into lockdown. Certainly, you've seen Hollywood play homage to these types of critical situations. But here you have Chinese military leadership stepping up to the plate and realizing that they needed to affect some sort of positive change to the situation in China. Now, Major General Chen Wei was the first military person, soldier, and as a field grade, a general officer, she was the first one to take the injection of the practice or vaccine that was being developed. It had not been tested on anyone, but basically she did what any good military leader and said, I will take the injection and I will expect that my soldiers will follow me as we try to defeat this pneumonia that has emanated here in Wuhan and basically sacrifice ourselves for the country. Quite remarkable if you think about it. Now, as part of their training, certainly all the soldiers know that this day is going to come. Yours truly, having been in the Marine Corps for almost 3 decades, this is one of those instances where you don't want to be that body laying there on the deck with a gas mask, nor do you want to be the one carried because you're incapacitated by people in rubber suits. Now, from a further military perspective, it's important that you understand this gentleman right here, Senior Colonel Yang Chengjun. Now, granted his history and experiences in nuclear strategy as part of military operations research, he decided to theorize during this outbreak who or why would someone want to look at this. And he came up with some very serious anecdotes in terms of these weapons of mass extinction, weapons of mass destruction, as we call them here in the Western world. And one of those features that he found very remarkably interesting is that they are low cost. You could basically kill millions of people with a single drop of some particular viruses. So he noticed and thought perhaps that this is very similar to what was happening during the Cold War with much more devastating effect from a mass casualty perspective. Now, he's not advocating, he's just curious as to why this is happening, because when you have a thermotoxin that could do such death by killing, you know, billions of people with a single drop, there's got to be something that must be done from a military perspective. Certainly the Chinese military has early warning types of systems as the one you see here, but more importantly, he wondered what would be the effect on a foreign adversary's military. And one of those was psychological shock. I will tell you, if you've ever been to the gas chamber as part of U.S. military training, it is done out of confidence. Granted, it's annoying, it's frustrating, and it can be dangerous. But until you have faced this, you can imagine that if you are a civilian and have never encountered this, this would essentially disintegrate and kill your will to survive or and live. You might even equate that with what might be happening in certain parts of our country today. Now, as part of that chemical warfare that the Chinese are wondering who would affect this on another country, he also thought about the silent effect. It is similar to cyber warfare in that it is the effect of winning without fighting, meaning the spread of a thermotoxin can be deployed and spread rapidly in multiple areas of a civilian world or incapacitate a military facility very quickly, essentially rendering the defense of a nation useless. Now, Senior Colonel Yang Chung-jung is not advocating this. He's just saying these are the effects that all militaries must deal with. And of course, the military in China will deploy sensors on the ground and certainly in the air to determine if an area has been infected. One of the most remarkable things that he discovered is that the consequences of these types of bioweapons are fairly serious, because not only will it make those that would want to operate kinetic weapon systems inoperable, but it will also cause them to lose their ability to essentially live normal lives. That is essentially indirect terrorism, if you think about it, because if you cause fear in a population or in a military, they lose their will to fight. So he knows that these consequences are serious and they should not be leveled against any adversary. Again, he's trying to find a message to get out to the world that they are trying to work together. Now, certainly cleansing systems, even in a nuclear world, but more importantly in a pandemic, requires cleansing. And here you have the Chinese military basically soaking down a vehicle for further use. But that does not mean that the virus has gone away. Once one of these man-made pandemics occurs in the form of an epidemic, it really starts to affect a large population of citizens within a country. When you start to see the death rate approaching 200,000, 250,000, it is perhaps past the point of no return. The Chinese do not want this on any other country. This is essentially what the senior colonel is talking about. But if those symptoms are not treated and the leadership of a country does not recognize that, he continues to theorize, then it becomes simply a zero-sum game for that adversary. Now, of course, testing the earth is interesting. You'll notice that these are foreign soldiers training with the People's Liberation Army. They are not Chinese. They are working with foreigners. Now, this will be a very curious theme as we get a few more slides into this presentation. And certainly here you can see a couple of PLA, nuclear, biological, chemical soldiers going to decontaminate an area. Now, what's really interesting is with General Chen Wei's first use of that experimental coronavirus vaccine, basically it started to indicate that that candidate for viral infection control was done by not only the PLA, the People's Liberation Army, but also CanSino Biologics. And it was added so that the viral trials would go on for 1 year. Although there would be three clinical trials, they all indicated that it could not be used on civilians. My research indicates that perhaps a controlled civilian population may be the rest of Xinjiang population in Western China. Now, of course, as they go through this, they begin to test. The Chinese military is testing the virus, not only in terms of protecting the soldiers, but also understanding that now you've got a civilian state-owned enterprise in China that is working with the PLA. They've gone through first and second clinical trials of this new coronavirus anti-vaccine. But what's interesting, as they've determined that the Communist Party has approved for only for internal use in the military for a period of 1 year, it's interesting that the stock price of CanSino has actually risen 284% due to the vaccine development that they're doing. You've heard me say this before. Here we have a communist country that has stock prices soaring during a pandemic. This is rather curious and very, very interesting. Now, of course, the Chinese military realize that they are indeed part of this biological test. What's interesting, though, is General Chen Wei is cautiously optimistic basically saying that these experimental results should not be interpreted without abandon. But basically what she is saying is now that they've encoded that gene protein and essentially attenuated it with a common cold virus to trigger an immune effect, that does not mean that the end state has been reached. What it means, though, is that there is at least a possibility of vaccine protection against the coronavirus infection. So the Chinese military is sacrificing part of its force structure in order to defeat this virus within the People's Republic of China. And of course, they have various testing assays going on. What's interesting about this is phase one was not necessarily effective for the Chinese military. There were side effects that were deadly. Certainly the military knows that when it signs up, the U.S. is no exception. A number of Chinese soldiers on the order of 6,000 or 7,000 lost their lives receiving this vaccine. But what's interesting, though, is CanSino has stated now just about a month ago, actually 3 weeks, that they have developed protocols that allow the vaccine to be developed, meaning that the phase one, while sadly a little bit of a failure, phase two is moving forward with some progress, and certainly phase three will go into effect as they start to inject more and more of the Chinese military population. And again, I mentioned that restive civilian population to the west of Beijing. And of course, the containment goes on from a military perspective, but most importantly, it's interesting to understand where is a lot of this study for further research coming out of? And I must take you to the Wuhan Institute of Virology. It's part of the Chinese Academy of Sciences, which is interesting because their mission is that essentially they will give full role of party consent and agreement and do exactly what the Communist Party tells it to do, meaning that they are fighting a fortress, as it says there, finding gaps in the information world for implementation and making sure that the State Council, the Central Party Committee, and the Chinese Academy of Sciences have the latest biosafety research possible. Now, this comes from their annual message, which was released not too long after the pandemic started to take hold in China. This is very interesting because it plays into why would they be doing this? Well, essentially, if you follow your news, the Department of Justice in the United States indicted two hackers last week. They were part of the Chinese Ministry of State Security out of Guangdong province down in the south by Hong Kong. What's interesting is they allege and are charging Li Xiaoyu and Dong Jiazhi of hacking computers, specifically those computers in countries that were working on a virus. Now, my question for you is, if the Chinese have a vaccine, why would they be sending cyber espionage agents across networks around the globe to try and find the antivirus protocols? One must wonder if they perhaps are failing and they realize they need to find another way to find that technology, or perhaps it's just another method of enhancing the research that they do have. And of course, when the winning of that CanSino vaccine has been developed, China will state that it is really taking the leadership position. Now, this is important not only from an economic perspective, but more importantly, from a state-owned enterprise. The China Biotech Corporation that you see here is really part of the China National Pharmaceutical Group. Why am I telling you this? Because this is a subsidiary of the Wuhan Institute of Biological Products, a biological technology company based in Wuhan, which is the epicenter for the Wuhan pneumonia or coronavirus. Essentially, you have some interesting fingers pointing from a hacking perspective, going against nation-state pharmacological, and antiviral research, and perhaps bringing it back to the very epicenter of the pandemic globally. And the Chinese are quite worried about this. You will not read about this in the Western press, but here you have it for your edification. Now, what's important about this, the Chinese view the opportunity now on the world stage to work with countries in the Middle East, which is not something they do from a military perspective. But it's interesting because they are now entering into anti-coronavirus vaccine trials with the United Arab Emirates, specifically in Abu Dhabi. This is very interesting because the Crown Prince in this particular case in UAE would not allow this type of joint disclosure unless indeed it had happened. And the Chinese press has capitalized on this, basically stating that the UAE is working and supporting China's fight against the corona epidemic and antivirus. So the Chinese believe that they are regaining the leadership position globally in the absence of any U.S. leadership. this one brings us back around to where we are, Biohacking Village, DEF CON 28 in the United States. So here we have a fractured relationship between the United States and China. And it's interesting because our Secretary of State, as the Chinese view it, continues to blame it. And when the Chinese hear things such as the Kung flu or other racist types of remarks, they can't but help but wonder, how can we possibly cooperate with the United States if they are blaming us when we are trying to find a solution that will essentially work with the world? What's interesting, though, is that across the Taiwanese Straits, that second state, Taiwan, they are very interested in this dialogue. They're actually stating that they are seeing the Communist Party of China, the CCP, talking about actually making claims that the U.S. Central Intelligence Agency was the one that concocted this. And that if you think back to the World Military Games a year ago in October of 2019, the U.S. military sent a number of soldiers there. They believe that they were actually biochemical agents taking bioweapons into Wuhan for the purposes of later deployment. So you can imagine that it is a lot of finger pointing back and forth in terms of who done it and where to solve. Now, last but not least, we have, of course, the Chinese wondering perhaps, will this ever end? What is happening in the United States? They used to be such great allies of us. We wonder, from a Chinese perspective, what is happening in the United States? And interestingly, they, being the Chinese, believe that there is no solid endgame here. And this is not a political statement from my perspective. It is simply a statement from the Chinese perspective that they are worried that the pandemic is starting to consume what used to be the global leader, the United States, out of sake of political gain or perhaps re-election for the current president of the United States. Now, conclusions. These are controversial across the board. The Chinese and the U.S. agree that the Wuhan virus was not man-made. However, Chinese researchers are not so certain of this. And their commentary indicates that there is a military source included with this. And of course, the response from a Chinese military perspective to the epicenter of the Wuhan epidemic in Wuhan is curiously compelling. And of course, number four, the consistent Chinese communist rhetoric blames the U.S. Department of Defense and military for the outbreak of this virus. Number five, the Chinese are cooperating with the Gulf Cooperation Council, excuse the bad pun, specifically the United Arab Emirates, in a world where they normally would not allow this, they being the UAE. The Chinese military, of course, under the leadership of Major General Chen Wei, have subjected themselves as the antivirus test, noting that there will be no civilian use except perhaps in Xinjiang and the rest of civilian population. China is curious and actually concerned that redirecting the virus source towards them is a narrative towards redirection and misdirection on the part of the U.S. elections, given the current leadership in the United States. And last but not least, if the U.S. cannot lead in this role, China is optimistic that the global leadership role will be theirs for the taking, and they feel that this is an important time for the Middle Kingdom to regain its historical position as a leader in biomedical research and get rid of the Wuhan pneumonia. That concludes my brief, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for attending. I will be available for questions when this is rebroadcast. 谢谢您, 再见了.